ages of ages.
Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Both now and ever, and to the ages of ages. Amen.
salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for those with faith, reverence, and the fear of God into their end, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Our Father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities and for armed forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Joshua, Ronnie, Adam, Andrew, Benjamin, Thaddeus, Connor, and Skyler, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those under persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, necessity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy Immaculate, blessed and glorious Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Surely, O Lord.
For unto thee are due all glory, honor, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Thank you.
Interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. Jesus appeared to be going further, but they constrained him, saying, "Stay with us, for it is now toward evening, and the day is now far spent." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread, and blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished out of their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" And they rose at that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 gathered together and those who were with them, and said, "The Lord is risen indeed, and has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread.
Behold, I will see the name of Jesus in the name of the enemy. sessions, exalt the horn of Orthodox Christians, and send down upon us thy rich mercies. Through the intercessions of our all-immaculate, late Theotokos, never Virgin Mary, by the might of the precious and life-giving cross, by the protection of the honorable, vitalist powers of heaven, at the supplications of thy honorable, glorious prophet, Warner and Baptist John, of the holy, glorious, all laudable apostles, Peter and Paul, and of all thy holy apostles, of our fathers among the saints, great hierarchs and ecumenical teachers, Basil the Great, Gregory the Theologian, and John Chrysostom, Athanasius, Cyril, and John the Merciful, Patrix of Alexandria, Nicholas of Myra, Spiridon of Prometheus, Nectarius of Pentapolis, the Wonder Workers, and our fathers among the saints, Tikhon, Patriarch of Moscow, and Raphael, Bishop of Brooklyn, of the holy, glorious, great martyrs, George the Trophy Bear, Demetrius the Myrrh Streamer, Theodore the Soldier, Theodore the General, and Venus the Wonder Worker, of the higher martyrs, Ignatius the God Bear of Antioch, Alampos, Eleutherios, of the holy, glorious, great women martyrs, Thecla, Barbara, Anastasia, Catherine, Kiriaki, Fatini, Marina, Prescova, and Irene, of the holy, glorious, right, victorious martyrs, of our venerable and God-bearing fathers who shone in the ascetic life, St. Barnabas, the patron and protector of this holy community, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, Tarasios, the confessor, Archbishop of Constantinople, our martyr, Aginos, the Bishop of Scopelios, the hieromartyr, Marcellus, the Bishop of Apamea in Syria, the martyr Alexander, whose memory we celebrate today, and of all thy saints, we beseech thee, O most merciful Lord, hearken unto the petitions of us sinners, who make our supplications unto thee, have mercy upon us.
Oh, and variant icon of the Father, through the intercessions of the holy confessors,
Theotokos, and the Mother of the Light, let us honor and magnify in song.
Now and ever and unto ages of ages. Church, O lover of mankind, rejoices in thee. O thou her bridegroom and her creator, who by thy will as becoming goddess rescued her from the worship of idols, and joined her to thee by thy precious blood, enjoying the elevation of the noble icons, wherefore she praises thee and
salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord. Churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for those who with faith, reverence, and the fear of God entered therein, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our Father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities, and for armed forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Joshua, Ronnie, Adam, Benjamin, Andrew, Thaddeus, Skylar, and Connor, let us pray to the Lord. For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those under persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, and necessity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all-holy Immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
For unto thee are due all glory, honor, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Amen. The Lord is King, he has clothed himself with majesty. The Lord is robed, he has girded with strength. For he has established the world so that it shall never be moved.
The intercessions of the Theotokos, O Savior, save.
Wisdom, stand upright.
Victory.
with strength.
Refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to share ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. And what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David, and Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, received promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, and put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release, that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and scourging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, ill-treated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering over deserts and mountains, and in dens and caves of the earth. And all these, though well attested by their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had foreseen something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect.
Peace be to thee that readeth.
Today known as Orthodoxy Sunday,
the day in which we celebrate the triumph of Orthodoxy. Well, what is the triumph of Orthodoxy? I think first we need to clarify what it is not, because people today are so used to a fractured Christendom, split into tens of thousands of denominations. I don't know how many, millions, 10,000, 20,000. That to talk about a triumph of Orthodoxy sounds like a boast, you know, like our denomination is better than yours, that kind of thing. But we have to remember that this term was coined long before the great schism of 1054, and even longer before the divisions caused by denominationalism in the West. There were no denominations when this term was first used. The triumph of Orthodoxy refers not to an exaltation of one church over another, but rather the triumph of the Christian faith, the faith itself, over a particular error that at that period has sought to weaken and corrupt the faith. So the whole controversy, and this is in the 8th century, centered on the proper role of holy imagery, the holy icons in the church. Many Christians today, I think, especially whose traditions do not use icons, would be deeply perplexed about this. And what are you talking about? The triumph of the Christian faith? Icons? You know, pretty images perhaps, make the place look very churchy, you know. But icons? How are they so important? They can scarcely imagine why icons matter at all. And you know, there's a fair number of Christians today who would actually, their beliefs would put them on the wrong side of the fence. They'd be counted with the iconoclasts in terms of their opinions. And the iconoclasts, by the way, icon smasher it means, were those who wanted to remove them from the church. They were called smashers because in many cases that's what they literally did. They went into churches and monasteries with axes and broke many holy and precious icons to bits, and sometimes the monks who were clinging to them as well. There were many, 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 many monks. In fact, following the controversy was a 10-year period of great persecution called the Decade of Blood, you know. I mean, we remember maybe the 60s as the Summer of Love, or something like that. The Decade of Blood doesn't sound like a time that you'd want to be around, you know. But historically, the use of icons dates back to Jewish times and was known and upheld with a much greater Christian understanding during the apostolic period and throughout the early church, as even secular archaeology continues to demonstrate over and over again. Every time they find a new church or a place where Christians met, there's icons, there's mosaics, there's all this imagery that you know, they can't find like an early church that was Quaker, let's say. filled with icons. And yet, speaking of Quakers, you know, there's always been a sort of puritanical movement in Christendom, I'd say. And just as sometimes we're prone to excess, we're also prone to excessive puritanism. And particularly over the icons, that there really grew a movement to banish the icons from the church. Why? The major charge, I mean, there's all kinds of social political reasons, but the major charge was that icons were being used as idols, that there were ignorant country folk Christian who were worshiping these images. And of course, if, you know, there's likely some truth to that. People make mistakes. And the church would certainly need to fully address and correct and teach on the proper use of these images. But to outright ban the icons or claim that they are always idolatrous in their use did not seem wise to the Holy Fathers. They realized there's something more going on here. The law of unintended consequences is rarely understood by the ban, this or that crowd. and a closer examination of the facts by cooler heads needed to take place. So an ecumenical council was held in 787 in Nicaea, the second council of Nicaea, because you remember the first ecumenical council was in Nicaea, and the last ecumenical council was in Nicaea. So they met or were convened, put forth clearly the Orthodox understanding and teaching regarding the holy images. It was decided by the fathers that the use of icons is so closely tied to incarnational theology that to eliminate one would do irreparable harm to the other. In other words, take away the icons, which are physical items depicting spiritual realities, and we lose a vital testimony of that joining of the immaterial God to the material creation. We have icons because of the incarnation. Before the incarnation, the invisible God could not be depicted by images. You know, it would just be the imagination of men. It would not represent any truth or reality. But when God took flesh and dwelt among us, all this changed. And people could now see, touch, kiss the image of their Creator, who was, of course, Jesus Christ, the image of God the Father. The icon of God is called in Colossians. Furthermore, the images of the saints, showing holy people, sanctified and glorified by their union with Christ, demonstrate the outworking of the incarnation in our lives. So you see, God in the flesh, portrayed by material icons, saints, filled with God and glowing forth, you know, with this divinity because of their union with Christ through the incarnation. It's all distinctly Christian. It's all Christian. Only really Christians have icons. Religions that, I mean, you know, I know there's other, but not in the same way, not the same thing as the icons that we have. Because, you know, if you don't believe in the incarnation, you believe in a spirit God, but not in the incarnation of God, then it's wrong to make an icon. Only the Christians who believe in the incarnation can have these, which are different from pictures. You know, if you want a picture or a statue of the Jolly Buddha, that's fine. But that's not an icon. That's not an image of the invisible God. And so according to our holy fathers, who are, of course, those men to whom all of us and all Christians owe their Christian faith. If you are a Christian today, whether Orthodox or not, you are a Christian today because of these men who went before you and preserved the faith. They stated that Christians who reject the use of holy imagery in the church stand in danger of losing the greater meaning of the incarnation in their lives. Now that's ancient wisdom, Christian Orthodox wisdom, and dismissed by many, many Christians today. They're like, oh, fluffy stuff. Of course I can believe in the incarnation without having icons in my church. Well, I'm not sure about that. You know, their warnings have come true in so many ways, considering that the veil of neo-Gnosticism has been laid across much of contemporary Christianity. Gnosticism, you know, is an ancient pagan philosophy rooted on a dualist thought. Dualism being, words here, the idea that matter is bad, spirit is good, right, basically boiled it down. Matter evil, spirit good. Matter false, spirit real, true. Even if, you know, it ranges in terms of matter being completely, what's the term that's used? Total depravity, you know, completely bad, beyond redemption, irredeemable, can only be destroyed in order for the spirit to be set free. You know, to maybe lesser versions of that being that matter just isn't as real as the spirit. Spirit is real. Well, this philosophy has permeated Western culture and Western Christianity, you know, in culture, you see it manifested in like the whole confusion over gender identity. If you were born a man, but you feel like a woman, what man doesn't have a net. But no, it's like, well, how do you fix that? In the old days, we had a thing called therapy. And you go to therapy and you get your head straightened out. But these days, because we're Gnostic, we say, well, my body is wrong. So I need surgery. I need to fix this and that. So my body can reflect what my spirit feels. Because body is less real than spirit. See, that's Gnosticism. That's not reality. And you know, it permeates in so many other ways, in terms of sexual identity, in terms of so many things, governments. When it filters into Christianity, what you wind up with often is, at very least, a kind of sacramentalism, which is not what you think. Sacramentarianism, I'm trying to say. It's the denial of the sacraments. In other words, why? Yeah, you know, it's like the body and blood of Christ is not really the body and blood of Christ. It's a symbol, because our minds and our spirits meditate on these things, and they are fed by this special knowledge. This is Gnostic. But you know, matter, you know, God doesn't use matter. You know, matter is fallen, right? Same thing with baptism. The baptism is just an outward sign of something that's already been done. You're born again when you believe, when you know. And you don't need to be dogged. That's just there to sort of demonstrate to the world that you were born again, right? That's Gnosticism. That's not Christianity. We say that God is redeeming matter. God is already redeeming matter. That water can be made holy, and thus we can be baptized in it and be joined to Christ physically, mystically, but physically. And the body and blood of Christ is mystically the body and blood of Christ. It is. We take matter, and by matter, we are saved by Christ's incarnation. This is incarnational, this is real, but it's too real for modern Gnostics, too real for many of our brethren who struggle even to believe in the incarnation, or, I don't know, the deity of Christ, or so many other things, because of this idea that God would not dirty his hands by dabbling in the realm of matter. In fact, he's just going to burn it all up one day, which is not true either. So, I realize people think, well, no, this is right out of the Bible. The Bible says that baptism isn't real. People's interpretations are influenced by a philosophy that has nothing at all to do with Christianity. And I'm sorry to say that, but it's true. I'm very sorry to say that. But it's been happening ever since the early church, because Gnosticism predates. Even though Irenaeus called it a Christian heresy, he was talking about the forms that manifest themselves in the Christian church that St. John wrote about. They went out from us because they were never of us. You cannot be Gnostic and be an Orthodox Christian. So these, you know, unfortunately, today many folks don't care. So what? Words, blah, blah, philosophy, who cares? I just, you know, I like to go along with what my friends believe so I can be popular. You know, if presented with facts, many people will react defensively or with indignation. Are you saying my own denomination is? Well, I'm saying that, first of all, denominations are wrong. But yeah, you know, Gnosticism affects real people. These false beliefs touch real lives. People need to take a closer look at what our fathers taught. And at the very least, you know, we do too. If we call ourselves Orthodox, we ought to really make sure that we are Orthodox. Orthodox through and through, in our practice, in the way that we live, in our beliefs. You know, we cannot go wrong with the world and its call. And it's such a temptation, because nobody wants to be a bad guy. Nobody wants to be called a hater, a homophobe, or, you know, whatever, or a Neanderthal. Some of us might be related, I don't know. But We have to be careful to be formed by our holy Orthodox tradition, not by the world, not by its teachings and philosophies, no matter how much they appeal to our sense of fairness or whatever like that. It's more important to know the truth, because it is the truth that sets you free. You think Bruce Jenner is free? Okay. You know, it's the worst kind of bondage comes when people subscribe to these philosophies rather than clinging to God, Christ. We need to take our cues not from what the culture teaches us, not from what the majority think, not from the hashtags of current social movements, but we need to value the fathers, the councils, the creeds, the canons, and our clergy, and take our direction from them. It might seem obvious, but you know, there's such a growing number of Orthodox today. I mean, I'm talking about Orthodox Christians who are embarrassed by the church and its traditions. They think that we are homophobic because we ask gay people to repent, join the community of the faithful, partake of communion with us, but repent. You know, that makes us homophobic. Or that we're misogynist because we don't have women priests as priestess. Well, you know. Yeah, we don't. But that doesn't make, you know, but I mean, this is what people think, right? Today, it's like, you know, we're an obstacle to be overcome because we're still traditional in our beliefs. And people are trying, I mean, I'm talking about people even in our seminaries that are trying to force progressive ideas on the church. Do you agree with them? Think they're right? Or do you think that's a terrible mistake? If you think that such activities are wrong and they undermine the Christian faith rather than liberate it, then live your life according to the fathers, according to our holy tradition. If you've got some things you've got to straighten out in your life, maybe you need to break a certain habit or you know, in order to become really, I mean, we're not Orthodox philosophically. We're either Orthodox in how we live or we're not. So we need to live like Orthodox. We need to become people of prayer and people of repentance. And that's more important than activism. Activism has a place, of course, but more important is to become truly and deeply Orthodox ourselves. Like I said once about the early church, how did they respond to the persecutions? Not by writing their congressmen or, you know, starting a Twitter storm. They responded by becoming scary, holy, so that they overcame the world. Well, that's how we do it. We need to turn our homes into houses of prayer. We need to become a people of prayer. Not just saying a few prayers before you dart out the door in the morning, you know, and forgetting to say prayers before you go to bed at night. We need to be in communion with God. We need to pray. We need to train our children to value the praise of God more than the praise of men. So they grow up knowing there's going to be a hostility to their faith. Guard yourself. Don't be scandalized when people say you're a weirdo because you believe stuff that's not popular. What are you, a hater? What are you, a Christian? You know. We need to fill our parishes with people who have come seeking salvation, not just socializing on Sundays. We need to fill our minds with the wisdom of the holy fathers and saints and mothers of the church, and not with what I guess you'd call the anti-wisdom of the world. We need to strive toward holiness, for the prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. Only in this way can the triumph of Orthodoxy continue in the world. You know, we won back then. We won our holy icons. We won our faith and belief in the Incarnation. Let's not fritter it away like people are trying to do today. Let's not just take all the blood that we shed to preserve that faith and just say, you know, it's not convenient to believe that stuff anymore. I might lose my job. People might hate me. What is the triumph?
of Orthodoxy. Ultimately, it is that we continue to believe the truth in a world filled with falsehood. That is the triumph. Truth. Truth that founded the universe. St. John wrote, "For whatever is born of God overcomes the world." And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Glory to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Fellow folks, save us, have mercy upon us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace, with God.
And guardian always, by thy life, we may ascribe glory unto thee, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages. Amen. kingdom, always now and ever and unto ages of ages. For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, for their quick release from captivity and safe return, the Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the President of the United States and all civil authorities and our armed forces everywhere, the Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Archpriest Wayne and his family, for Kevin and his family, for Autumn, Alexandros, for Aaron, Teresa, Ron and Judy, Laura, Juliet, Ambrose, Declan, and their sponsors and their families, for Wanda and Nicole, for Charlotte, Aubrey, Maggie, Sophia, Stacy, Christina, and Nadia, that they have mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, pardon and remission of their sins. The Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Orthodox servants of God departed this life, especially for Chad and for John, Lord God, remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Let us ask of the Lord.
Blessed is the Lord, as Lady of the Apostles, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God. Let us love one another, that with one accord we may confess.
Visible and invisible, who sitteth upon the throne. Christ, our great God and Savior, our hope, who is the image of thy goodness, the seal of equal type, in himself showing forth thee, the Father, the living Word, the true God, the wisdom before all ages, the life, sanctification, life, the true life, through whom the Holy Spirit was manifested, the Spirit of truth, the gift of adoption, the pledge of an inheritance to God, the first fruits of eternal good things, the life-giving power, the fountain of holiness, by whom enabled every rational and intelligent creature to serve thee and send up to thee perpetual praise. For all things are thy servants. Yea, archangels and angels, thrones, dominions, principalities, authorities, powers, and the many-eyed cherubim praise thee. Round about thee stand the six-winged seraphim, and with wings they cover their faces, and with wings their feet, and with wings they fly, continually crying out to one another with unceasing praises. Singing the triumphal hymn, shouting, proclaiming, and singing.
Broken it, he gave it to his holy disciples and apostles, saying,
remission of sin. Liberty, those who are blessed by unclean spirits. Travel with those who journey by land, by sea. sea and air. Defend the widows, protect the orphans, free the captives, heal the sick, and those who are under trial, in the mines, in exile, in every tribulation, necessity, and danger. Remember, O God, all those who beseech thy great loving kindness, and those also who love us, and those who hate us, and those who have enjoined us, unworthy though we be, to pray for them. And be mindful, O Lord our God, of all thy people, and upon all pour out thy rich mercy, granting to all their petitions which are unto their salvation. And those through whom ignorance or forgetfulness or the multitude of names we have not remembered, do thou thyself remember, O God, who knowest the time of life in the name of each, and knowest every man, even from his mother's womb. For thou, O Lord, art the helper of the helpless, the hope of the hopeless, the savior of the storm dogs, the haven of the voyager, the healer of the sick. Be thou thyself all things to all men, O thou who knowest every man, his condition, his dwelling place, and his need. Deliver, O Lord, this city and every city and countryside from famine, plague, earthquake, flood, fire, sword, invasion of enemies, and civil war. On the first, be mindful, O Lord, of our father and metropolitan Joseph. Do thou grant unto thy holy churches in peace, safety, honor, health, and length of days, and rightly dividing the word of thy truth. Pardon me every transgression, both voluntary and involuntary, and withhold not, because of my sins, the grace of thy Holy Spirit from these gifts here spread forth. Be mindful, O Lord, the priesthood, the diaconate, and Christ in every priestly rank, and put not to confusion any one of us to stand about thy holy altar. Visit us with thy loving kindness, O Lord. Manifest thyself unto us in thy rich compassions. Grant us temperate and healthful seasons. Give gentle showers upon the earth, unto fruitfulness. Bless the crown of the year of thy beneficence. Make the schisms of the churches to cease. Quench the ragings of hostile nations. Speedily destroy by the might of thy Holy Spirit uprisings and heresies. Receive us all into thy kingdom, making us children of the light and of the day. And grant unto us thy peace and thy love, O Lord our God, for all things thou hast given unto us. Grant us with one mind, dwell in one heart, with glorified praise, thy all honorable and majestic name, of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and into ages of ages.
Amen.
The mercies of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all.
Upon
forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Thank you.
fear of God, with faith and love draw near.
O God, save thy people and bless thine inheritance.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
The prophets beheld, as the apostles have taught, as the church has received, as the teachers have dogmatized, as the universe has agreed, as grace has shown forth, as truth has revealed, as falsehood has been dissolved, as wisdom has presented, as Christ has awarded, thus we declare, thus we assert, thus we preach Christ our true God. And honor his saints in words, in writings, in thoughts, in sacrifices, in the churches, in holy icons. On the one hand, worshiping and reverencing Christ as God and Lord, and on the other hand, honoring as true servants of the same Lord of all, and accordingly offering them veneration. This is the faith of the apostles. This is the faith of the fathers. This is the faith of the Orthodoxy. This is the faith which has established the universe.
So,
Christ our God, have mercy on us and save us.
Amen.